So last week we were talking about presidential character and how the different presidents' personalities and their own agendas have kind of shaped their presidency and their legacy that they've left it behind. To wrap up some of those, I don't think we were able to get to the presidents. Jimmy Carter, he's known as a Washington outsider. Recall that he was the one that ran against Washington. He was often a micromanager. And we saw that this worked for him in some ways, but in other ways, especially in dealing with foreign policy, this was, kind of had a negative effect on the nation. Under Ronald Reagan, he set policy priorities, gave his staff a lot of latitude and flexibility, and he was a leader of public opinion. He loved to use public opinion polls, and he liked to appeal to the people, kind of using his actor background to kind of propel his personality inside of the presidency. We saw Bush Sr. was more of like a hands-on manager. He had a lot of Washington experience before becoming president. He was vice president under Reagan. And so he had a lot of experience within Washington, and he was able to use that to his benefit when he was managing certain scenarios and situations. Most successfully, his the short conflict of the Gulf War, he was able to keep that short because of his experience and his action that he took. Bill Clinton, we know, was a great communicator. He appealed to a lot of people because of his personality. And he was more liberal, but he kind of stuck to the centrist policies in the spectrum. He fell more towards the center of being liberal. He was not necessarily extremely left-winged. And then lastly, Bush Jr., he ran Washington really tight, especially his White House staff. He kept them really close to him, and he wanted to make sure that he managed them really well. And we know that his agenda became dominated by foreign affairs post 9/11. So most of his presidency was dealing with the ramifications of 9/11 and the war on terror, which he did not anticipate, but really shaped the way that his, the 7 years after kind of fell. So moving on to the president's agenda, a lot of presidents, display their agenda in different ways, but a lot of it has to do with the resources that they have access to, depending upon interest groups, aides that they hire, their campaign advisors, or what bureaus and agencies they tap into, or whatever outside specialists they might hire. They get opinions from all of those people, which kind of shape the way that the president not only forms his opinion, but his agenda for policy. We know that different presidents have different approaches. We saw that Carter and Clinton tried to have a policy on everything, whereas Reagan concentrated more so on a number of small ideas, and he left everything else to his subordinates, so he was more managerial, whereas Carter and Clinton tried to be really hands-on. Successfully, it worked for Clinton, not so much for Carter. Reagan, though, being able to delegate tasks worked really well for him. So being able to implement different policies through their agenda is depends upon a lot on their style and their own personality. Now, there are a lot of constraints on president programs, some of these being like congressional reactions or how the public will react, the time or the attention that the president can dedicate to that issue. If an unexpected crisis comes up, for example, like I mentioned, September 11th, Bush never anticipated it, but it dominated his presidency. And programs can be changed only marginally. Most resources actually are already committed, and we discussed this when we talked about the budget. A lot of the budget is already slated for, and there's not a lot that you can implement without sweeping change. And then, of course, some presidents allow public opinion polls to kind of drive their agenda and what issues they think should come to the forefront of their policy. So some presidents allow polling and public opinion polls to influence their own agendas more. So just like when we talked about congressional representatives and senators and how they, take to polling and different approaches they might take to implementing legislation, the same is true for the presidency and how he implements different policy from the White House. There's, of course, the idea that he can take the trustee approach, what's best for the American public, for the good of all people, regardless of what the popular opinion is, but he does have to be careful because opinion polling, especially if he wants re-election, is really important. And that perception of the American people, although we use the Electoral College, it's still important what the American people think of the president, especially if you want to run for a second term. And so that's why a lot of times if the presidents have something that may not be in favor with public opinion, they want to do it very early because the public has that short memory and then they can forget about it the time re-election comes around. Secondly, they can take a more delegate approach, act as the constituents wish, and this is where polling will influence a president more often. They can poll about anything, and a lot of times they'll poll about what kind of policy is more favorable or what language is more favorable. And so the president knows, even before he makes a statement or goes into Congress to try and implement a policy or goes, you know, overseas to work on foreign policy, that what will be appealing to the public and what won't. In this case, we saw a lot of polling happen with Barack Obama prior to his speeches that were made on the Health Care Reform Act, and he was able to kind of shape his language so that it would be more appealing and more approachable to the American public and wouldn't be so daunting. Now, almost every president since 1928 has tried to reorganize government in some way or change the structure. Most of that happens within the White House staff. The president organizes his staff in the way that best suits his personality and management style. But sometimes it's in the way that the departments and the agencies work, and that's known as the bureaucracy, and we'll get to that within the next couple of days. So we've seen, you know, major proposals for reorganization, and it's easy for presidents to claim that they want to reorganize the bureaucracy. The bureaucracy, as you'll find out, comes under a lot of blame for, you know, inefficiencies in government and things of that nature. So it's easy for the president to target that, and it's appealing to the American public. But one of the most major changes most recently was when George Bush Jr. Implemented the Department of Homeland Security, a brand new department that had never been there before. So that was a major reorganization. Most of the time, you don't see these reorganizations as sweeping as that. Some reasons that this is appealing: we have a large number of agencies and departments. It's easier to change policy by reorganization than starting from scratch. It's easier to tweak than start anew. And so a lot of times, the reorganization outside of the White House staff must be congressionally approved. And so it's easy for the president to reorganize his own staff because that doesn't have to go through Congress. We've seen different transitions from the presidents throughout the years. The presidential transition is kind of an interesting issue. Only 15 of our 41 presidents have served two full terms, including Bush and now Obama. We have the vice president has succeeded, you know, to the presidency only 8 times. That's not happened that often. We've had only 5 VPs who have won the presidency in an election, which is not due to death, so on their own. And part of that is because the presidency is more of a kind of an empty job. You're doing it solo. The vice president presides over the Senate. He's not always there. He votes if it's in a tie. The vice president also has leadership powers in the Senate, but they're weak. And so the vice presidency doesn't have a lot of power. This becomes kind of a empty job where a lot of vice presidents are, you know, left for wanting more. And so we see that they seek other options, not necessarily the presidency, but sometimes even afterwards the vice president will go back to Senate or go back to the House of Representatives to serve. But we have some problems with succession. Early laws that attempted to define succession were not very successful. In the Constitution, it really only says that the vice president is allowed to serve as acting president if the president can't, or if in the case of death of the president. There's no actual line of succession for after that. And then there were a series of laws in the 1800s and early 1900s that attempted to define succession and the order that it would occur in. Some of them had the president pro tempore coming after the vice president. Some of these reorganizations have had settled on the Speaker of the House being third in line. But it really was solidified in 1967 with the passage of the 25th Amendment. This allowed the vice president to serve as acting president if the president is disabled. There's no clear definition on disabled, so that could be illness or death. Illness is decided by president, vice president, and the cabinet, or by a two-thirds vote of Congress. So if he's just unable to perform his duties, there has to be some kind of group consensus there. The vice president ascends to office because of death or resignation, must name a new vice president. So this is the case like of Nixon and Ford, okay? Or even in the case there where the vice president stepped down, Nixon needed to name a new vice president. And then the new vice president must be confirmed by a majority vote of both houses. So he can't just appoint whoever he wants. Has to be approved by both houses, so your checks and balances are there as well. Lastly, we know some problems of succession occur because of impeachment. We've only had two presidents that have ever been impeached, Andrew Johnson and Bill Clinton. First, you have the impeachment vote that occurs in the House, and then the indictment part in the criminal trial, which occurs in the Senate. Both of them were impeached, but neither of them were removed from office, meaning that they were found not guilty by trial. But it's been much more common for, Supreme Court justices to be impeached by presidents. We've only had 2 out of 42 presidents impeached, whereas we've had quite a number, I think 15 or 16 Supreme Court justices that have been impeached. So it does happen more often for a justice than for a president. But that's just because of the nature that on the Supreme Court, there's 9 of them. So there's more people there to possibly impeach over time. So that concludes our discussion on presidential agenda. Next week, we'll be taking a look at how the presidential agenda can influence how laws are implemented and upheld through the bureaucracy. And the bureaucracy and its complexities as an organization of the government, and as some people call it, the fourth branch of government. So look for those notes as we go back to class after all these snow days.